after the India became independent, I think Congress had a very important historical role for Indian society. And that historical role was as follows. You see, our left, let me conventionally divide our politics into life, right, left, and the center as a kind of a spectrum, but as three very important points. The problem with our left was, and continues to be, that nobody accused the left of being dishonest or corrupt or any such thing. People would say nice things, but nobody, they would not, common people would not support left, because left was considered to be too cosmopolitan, too devoid of culture, too devoid of that warm flavor, the warm blood, the warmth of life, the traditions, the relationships, etc., etc. However bad they are, people, you know, left was so completely, it appeared so completely cosmopolitan that people did not have much taste for that kind of cosmopolitanism.
I am curious to understand the becoming of the historian Salil Mishra, who holds so many things, such enormity in his personality.
Well, Dave, it all started at JNU. And when I joined JNU at the Center for Historical Studies in 1979, I noticed, I experienced, I witnessed three or four very interesting, curious developments. First development, of course, was that we came into contact with the best minds of the times. In my first semester, MA first year, the four courses and the four teachers for those four courses that I had, I must share it with you. One course was taught by Romila Thapar, one was S. Gopal, one was Bipan Chandra, and one was S. Bhattacharya.
How wonderful.
So a student of MA first year, first semester, was exposed to these four greats, four different styles of scholarship, four different styles of teaching, etc. You know, so that was nothing short of a real opening of the mind and enlightenment for me. The other thing I noticed in JNU was that there was a great sense of community in the university.
But
the community was not, community was determined along the lines of disciplines and fields and the areas. So history people had a community, social scientists had a community, international scholars had a community, language people had a community. So suddenly I discovered that I was a small member, but nonetheless a member of this extremely enlightened community, which also had Romila Thapar, Bipan Chandra, S. Gopal, Bhattacharya, Panikkar, Harbans Mukhya. They were the members of the same. So we were members of the same community, some as students, some as teachers. But nonetheless, there was a seamless continuity of the membership of the community. This kind of a community feeling was really encouraged and promoted in JNU. That gives you a very exalted feeling that makes you want to stay in the community. So many of my batchmates, they became historians, either teachers of history or researchers or in the media, because it was intoxicating. It was simply intoxicating to be a member of this community, which has such illuminaries as its members. And there was a sense of continuity and commonality. You know, I remember there was a discussion going on at Lawns down campus, because JNU was at the down campus, and Romila Thapar walked in and she just joined, and she just joined. She said she would like to join, and she joined the discussion because it was a history discussion. So, you know, so this membership of a, this notion of a community and the membership of community was extremely important. The third important development that happened was that in a very subtle and in a very disguised and not a very explicit manner, there was a great sense of nationalism about JNU. It was a very nationalist institution, though not in the sense in which nationalism subsequently came to be understood. The basic idea was that in the world of social sciences, there should be something called an Indian social science. India is an old civilizational society. We cannot simply go on duplicating and replicating the conceptual resources that come from the West. Some of them may not be suitable for India. India is a very distinctive society, old society, civilizational society. We have our own old philosophy. So we need to create our own social science, which would not be insular, which would not be indigenous, which would not be narrow and isolated. But nonetheless, India should be reflected in the basic social science concepts. But India should also, Indian scholarship, Indian social scientists should also create their own concepts. Let me give you just two, a slightly funny story, but it's not exactly a funny story. It's a very, it's very illustrative. It's a very important story. In our first three semesters, when we taught, when we learned, and our teachers, they would make us aware of some particular concept. Concepts were very, very important. Concept is, you know, is the currency of social sciences. We understand the world, the society, people, their institutions with the help of concepts. In my first semester, Romila Thapar, in a course on ancient society,
this was in 1980s, early 1980s.
In 1979. My master's was between 79 and 81. Okay. So this course was in 1979. She made us understand the concept and spent one whole day, one whole lecture in it, Asiatic mode of production. And after we had learned the outline, the meaning of the concept, and she said, but India doesn't fit into it. The concept is not very valid. It's false. There is some problem with the concept. We cannot mechanically apply it to Asian societies, Asiatic mode of production. And we kept wondering that she spent one whole lecture trying to explain Asiatic mode of production only to say that it actually did not happen in India. It doesn't work on India. It's not applicable to India. In my second semester, there was a course on feudalism, and Professor Harbans Mukhya used to teach it. He had his presidential address in the History Congress with a very catchy and a provocative title, Was There Feudalism in India? He also made us understand feudalism, the theories, the debates, what is its meaning, etc. And this his conclusion was, of course, that feudalism did not happen in India. There was nothing called an Indian feudalism. In the third semester, there was a course which Professor K.N. Panikkar used to take. This was on History of Ideas. And 19th century. So the whole world of ideas in the 19th century, from Ram Mohan Roy to Keshav Chand Sen to Arya Samaj, you know, the very exciting, very fascinating field of social and political ideas of the 19th century. And there he would spend a lot of time discussing the Renaissance. And he would tell us what Renaissance was, its European context, resurgence and the cultural efflorescence and literature and music and all that. And then he would also say very polemically that there was no Renaissance in India and there is a problem because it's a British construction. Our 18th century were not dark ages. So British would like us to believe that 18th century was a period of dark ages and 19th century was the Renaissance. So there was a pattern to it all. Asiatic mode of production, we must know, but we must know that it did not happen in India. Feudalism, we must understand, but we must also understand that it cannot mechanically be applied to India. Renaissance, we must understand, but we must know whether it happened. We must debate it. He used to have he would give a whole assignment to us saying, was there a Renaissance in India in the 19th century? And we knew that if we proved that there was no Renaissance, we will get a better grade because that is what he wanted us to write. Now, there was a pattern to it. And the pattern to it is that the global conceptual currency, we must not cut ourselves off from. Some part of our mind should be open. It should be absolutely cosmopolitan. It should be global. We must know what's happening in the world of ideas, in the world of social sciences, in the world of concept formation. We cannot isolate. But we cannot also mechanically apply it to India. We must have our mind should be cosmopolitan. But as the sociologist, as Professor Yogendra Singh would say, your feet have to be in the realities. Yes. Our feet have to be in Indian realities. So Indian realities are as important as context-free, cosmopolitan concepts. And we cannot sacrifice realities for the sake of concepts. So we must explore India. We must be empirically, our social sciences must be empirically rooted in Indian realities and committed towards an exploration of Indian realities, India's past, society, social structure. And we should create our own concepts. but we should not close ourselves towards what's happening elsewhere, what's happening in the world, the global concepts, etc. So there is a sense of nationalism to it that, you know, we have to develop Indian social sciences or something called Indian social sciences, not in a very exclusive and an isolating manner, but in an enriching manner. The global concepts have to be enriched in the light of Indian experiences. So nationalism, we must not turn our eyes to nationalism, but we cannot go on defining nationalism in the manner in which many European scholars have defined it, in which India cannot even find a place. The European imaginations of nationalism are such that you can't find a place for India. But that does not mean that we are going to neglect nationalism. Right. We will enrich nationalism, and we will enrich nationalism conceptually by providing the Indian input, by telling the world about, look at a very unique historical experiences of nationalism, which comes from India. So I would put it all down to my 2 or 3 years in JNU, where suddenly I was just exposed to this whole world. You write a tutorial, we would write a tutorial in one semester, we would do 8 tutorials. There were 4 courses, and for each course, we had to write 2 assignments. And every assignment had to be defended to a community, which meant that, you know, it's just not enough to write out things. When you write something, you've committed yourself to those ideas. You have to defend them. And if you cannot defend it, then you'd better go back and do some more work.
Okay.
So I think it was this experience at JNU, at the level of training, at the level of social science, at the level of indoctrination, at the level of socialization, being the membership of this exalted community. I think all that shaped our minds collectively and the entire generation, me and our generation. I mean, many of the people of my generation would entirely agree with what I am saying. They would also say the same things about the institution, which made us.
Yeah, I can understand. I mean, there are two lines emerging from whatever you have said, and primarily telling us that, you know, this whole hullabaloo about JNU is so under-informed about what JNU was and probably is in some sense. One is this academic culture in which an eminent scholar, historian such as Romila Thapar and other teachers in JNU would join in students' discussion, and there won't be any sense of hierarchy, and everybody would have this kind of conversation going on various issues. The second is the national Indian ethos at the backdrop of all kind of experiments. We will return to these points later, but I would like to hear from you your turn to Gandhi, Nehru, and the legacy. I mean, and you. You developed it. I mean, you honed it to a great extent. And in your writings also, it reflects very well. So, yes. So,
I would put it down to my guru, my teacher, Professor Bipan Chandra. He's no more. He passed away on 30th of August, 2014. Bipan Chandra, as a teacher, he used to sometimes be very deliberately provocative towards himself. I mean, he would say things which would seem like an anachronism, and then he would settle down to kind of explain it. Some of his anachronisms were very interesting. One, of course, was he would quite often say, "I am a Gandhian Marxist." And, you know, and this would make no sense. He would say, "I am a Marxian nationalist. I am a Marxist, but I am also a nationalist." And then he would wait for some student to tell him that Marx did not really, you know, Marx was a kind of an internationalist who would look down upon nationalism. So how can you be a nationalist and a Marxist at the same time? And then he would explain that it is, for Indians, it is anti-imperialism, which makes us a Marxist. My anti-imperialism during the course of the nationalism, that makes me a Marxist, because I look at British imperialism through a Marxian lens. But it is my anti-imperialism which makes me a nationalist, because during the course of a nationalism, during the course of a national movement, if you were anti-imperialism was an important part of being a Marxist. So he said, it's my location, it's my grounding, it's the time which makes me a Marxist and a nationalist at the same time. So he would make superficially contradictory statements and then start digging deeper to find deeper linkages. He this was a part of his journey, his own intellectual journey,
right.
But in a kind of, in a very infectious kind of way, some of it, this methodology also, we also became a part of it, and we also began to ask these kinds of questions. How is it that, you know, methodologically, you are also rooted in JNU? One allegation which the opponents of JNU make is true, is that of Marxism. The thing, nationalism, etc., is complete nonsense. I mean, JNU was a very nationalist institution. It consciously wanted to create a community of teachers and students. I mean, they consciously said that JNU means its teachers and students, etc. But yes, if someone wants this as an allegation of Marxism, a Marxian bias, that I would admit to. So if that's a charge, I would let it stick. I will not counter against it. In our history center, I know that many of our courses, they were very clearly informed by, if you want to call it Marxian bias, I will not call it a bias, but I would say a rooting, a certain lens, a way of looking. Let me give you an example, and then I'll come back to my Gandhi Marx question. It was quite commonplace in economics, MA economics, for people to read Adam Smith, Ricardo, and Marx. In sociology, it will be Weber and Durkheim, and Marx. Yeah. In political science, it'll probably be Montesquieu and Voltaire and someone, and Marx. Marx was like a common factor, whether it was economics or sociology or political science. Interestingly, it was at the History Center that there was no separate course on Marxism. Marx as a philosopher, as a scholar, was never taught. I had to go to sociology to do a course with Professor Yogendra Singh to study Marx and Weber. But in History Center, there was no place for Marx as an exclusive theme of study. But everything was taught in the Marxian way. So Marx was not a theme. Marx was a kind of a lens, Marxism, through which, look at it this way. Ancient society, we would study the mode of production debate. We did not study medieval world. We studied feudalism. So it was not medieval world. It was not agrarian world. It was not agrarian societies. The words were chosen carefully. It was feudalism. We did not study industrial society for modern times. We studied capitalism and colonialism.
Okay.
We did not study modern China. Our course was communism in modern China.
Okay.
We did not study modern Russia. We studied Russian Revolution. Professor Madhavan Malat, he was not a Marxist. But he taught a course, and the title of the course was not Modern Russia or Russian History. It was Revolution. And the whole course was structured around revolution. It was not just about the revolution. It was about 19th century traditions and what it led to and so on. But the title of the course was Russian Revolution. There would be courses like right-wing movements in Europe. But then right-wing is such a Marxian way of looking at it. Right-wingers don't call themselves right-wingers. Left-wingers call them right-wingers. So this Marxian thing was constantly there. It was a part of the air that we breathed. So tutorial mode of production, seminar mode of production, our language also became quite Marxian. Mode of production, revolution, and things like that. So that charge would be true. Anyway, coming back to this thing. So it was, I think, it was Professor Bipan Chandra's idea. He just felt that not Marxism as a tool, as a methodology, as a paradigm, it's maybe less relevant for the developed European countries because it may not just apply there. You know, this is what people like, scholars like Gramsci, etc., were grappling with. They felt that the revolution, Marxian revolution, did not happen in developed European societies. It happened in Russia, and, you know, and why did it happen? And why was a socialist revolution unlikely to take place in the European countries? So Bipan Chandra also believed and argued that Marxism as a tool of analysis, as a way of understanding the society, may be less relevant for the developed European society, but it's very important for the third world countries, for countries like India and China and others. I mean, because it gives us a thesis. It's a thesis of transformation. He would not call it revolution, but he said it's a thesis of transformation. So if you're interested in social transformation as a social scientist, which our first generation social scientists were, essentially all their social sciences in the 50s and the 60s, they were geared to facilitating the task of social transformation of India along modern lines, along egalitarian lines.
Right.
So their researches were geared to it. If you look at the quality of research in the 1950s, they were all such which should facilitate the state or other agencies in carrying out social transformation of the country. So social transformation was very central to the research priorities of our social scientists of that generation after 1947. And this brought Bipan, this brought Bipan also close to Gandhi.
Okay.
Because he also did not look at Gandhi purely in terms of anti-imperialist struggle and leadership. He did. Gandhi provided the strategic framework for the launch of the anti-imperialist struggle. But, you know, as we have now discovered, there is so much more to Gandhi.
Yes.
Gandhi actually, in his own ways, he has a thesis of social transformation.
Yes, he does.
And any scholar who is engaged in this task of social transformation, trying to look at the blueprint of India's social transformation, you cannot escape Gandhi.
Right. Right.
And you cannot escape Marx, because Marx is very relevant for the non-European. Interestingly, that's the thing, for the non-European societies. So this is actually a meeting point in which between Marx and Gandhi, there is absolutely no either or for us. Marx gives us the global picture. And Gandhi, actually, because he worked on India and he lived in India, he gives you the nitty-gritty. Of how to carry out what should be the blueprint of social transformation for a society, for a large, diverse, plural, traditional, civilizational society like India. Yeah. The task is enormously complex and challenging, but that is what makes it important for us to reach out to both Marx and Gandhi.
Right, right. So just to spend a little more time on the question of history, you have almost spent, close to 40 years association you have with history, history as a domain of inquiry.
Right.
And in these 40 years, I'm sure you must have encountered quite a few unresolved issues with the way history is done, the idea of history that we have. I mean, whatever answer to the question, what is history, that we have harbored, what were the unresolved issues when you started your journey as a historian? And do you find those issues unresolved even now? Or what is going to be the course of doing history in future? And future would start from here, which is like pandemic ridden today. And in that context, we are thinking of future. So to begin with, what were the unresolved issues in history that continued to live with you? You kept thinking about them, whether they are still unresolved.
Yes, some of them are resolved, but some of them are still very, very unresolved. One unresolved issue is really that I find very intuitively attracted towards the 19th century vision of history, of social science writing, which was rooted very much in positivism and so on, a sense of big picture, you know, and the notion that there can be something called a global history. Connections across times are important. Historians are able to make connections across time, but connections also across spaces, Europe and non-Europe and so on. So the way I have been brought up and the kind of readings that I have done, I find myself increasingly attracted to the 19th century view of social science writing and social science history. Now, I'm also aware that view, there are certain risks in it. That one risk is, of course, a certainty. You can always fall prey to a certain kind of certainty, you know, the kind of certainty which comes from objectivity and from this claim that you can write objective history, objective social sciences, which we know is not a very valid claim. So that, of course, is one. The second, of course, thing is what to do about Europe. Now, there's this big thing. There is a big elephant in the picture, elephant in the big room of historical inquiry and social science inquiry is Europe, modern Europe. What to do? quite clearly you can say that we must ignore Europe. And our history writings and our social science writings have been, in every sense, dominated so much by Europe at the level of curriculum, at the level of institutions, what to research, you know.
Right.
The period of social science is the period of European ascendancy over the world, the tiny 100 years or so. But that is the time in which our social sciences were born. So what to do with Europe? As a reaction to all that European domination, you can say that let's neglect Europe. Let's pretend it does not happen or it did not happen and do our own researches. Now, that obviously does not happen. How to recognize the historical and various other kinds of superiority which Europe, European countries, societies enjoyed and they still enjoy, but how not to fall prey to Eurocentricism?
Yes.
Whether at the level of inquiry, at the level of concepts, and so on. This is almost like a tightrope walk. These dilemmas are never resolved. But these are dilemmas one has to be aware of and one has to constantly address it. The other dilemma, of course, would be, just stop me whenever you have a question, because I'll probably go on speaking. The other dilemma, of course, pertains to India. You know, we recognize that India has an old history, it has a dynastic continuity, it's an old civilizational society. I am not using the word civilization in the sense of superiority. I am not saying that civilizational societies are necessarily superior to segmental societies or other kinds of society. I am simply recognizing that there are historical distinctivenesses. Civilizational societies like India, like China, they bring in their own flavor, their own constraints. Now, because India is a civilizational society, change has to be always, it accompanies continuity. You cannot make a break of the kind which some of the European countries could make. There is always an ambivalent attitude towards tradition. Sometimes there is a celebration of tradition. Sometimes there is a tendency to look upon all negative features in the tradition, patriarchy, caste system, religion, superstition, etc.
Right.
So how to recognize these features of Indian society, civilizational society, continuity, etc. How not to glorify them, but how also not neglect them in one's own inquiry.
Treat
them as facts of the matter. And then do comparisons with other similar and other kinds of non-civilizational societies.
Within that ambit, would there be any reflection on micro history or what some people call, I mean, the post-colonial turn in history or the category of subaltern?
I would not call it a dilemma for me, but these are very important debates that have enriched our history writing, and we have to constantly recognize it, but also recognize that things do not end with, you know, subaltern studies, history from below was a very, very important intervention. Yes. But after this intervention was made, it became a kind of orthodoxy of the times. And when became an orthodoxy of the times, then even that needed to be critiqued. So I think history particularly has to be constantly rewritten because there is more past. History is the most, it's an expanding discipline because there is always more past, you know, because past is always enlarging. There is more past, there is more data, there are more perspectives constantly there are more themes. Now you would know that a history student today must know enough about gender, caste, environment. But when I did my MA, I did not study neither gender nor caste nor environment. This is a very significant addition in the last 2 or 3 decades, and now it has to be done. But that does not make other things unimportant. Other things continue to be important, but there are these recent additions. So these interesting negotiations have to be made because they're happening all the time. New interventions are being made, new data is available, new themes are available, and new perspectives post-colonial first there. So it's a kind of one has to constantly negotiate one's way through as a researcher. But I said it's not a dilemma for me, because I do feel that you have to be open to all these possibilities, but one has to be also rooted somewhere. Rooted not in a very dogmatic kind of sense, rooted very much in a Gandhian kind of sense. I mean, he said that, you know, I would like the the influences from where all over come. But I do not want to be swept off my feet. I mean, he said it's better to be stuck in the mud than to be swept off your feet. So with all these new things coming, it is always possible for young scholars to be swept off their feet. I would, ideal scenario is where there you remain your openness, your accountability, your accessibility to all kinds of new things that are happening, but create a constituency, create a thematic constituency, methodological area, and remain there. Don't so easily, don't float. I mean, for a historical, for a history scholar, so many of us start floating, which is not such a good thing. Don't float, but remain open. Remain open to things. So that's a challenge, not so much of a dilemma, but it's an important challenge.
And the reason why this discussion is important, because given the situation right now, the pandemic, the lockdown, and the kind of threat that we face in our day-to-day life, it's a threat in everyday life. And it seems that any part of social science will have to refashion itself so that it can deal with this mundane or even banal or everyday emotions. So would there be another kind of, you know, variation emerging within historiography in India, which will show us the possibility of making a historical documentation of the everyday during pandemic, even after the pandemic? I mean, pandemic is a time which demands from all of us, even if we are not willing to do it, but it demands from all of us certain kind of intellectual reflexivity. So that's the reason why I was taking you through these questions.
Yeah, you know, there was for a historian, there are two kinds of dilemmas. Let me deal with both of them separately. First, of course, is what to do with ideology. And here, when I say ideology, I mean a kind of belief system, strong beliefs which people have and which as citizens we also have. Nationalism is an ideology because it's also a sentiment, emotion, a kind of belief system. Now, increasingly, you would find that many themes of historical inquiry are such in which there are very strong such pressures which emanate from the society on the question of caste, on the question of gender, on various other such questions. You know that there are strong ideologies. There are so movements that are going on.
Yes.
And movements, they also affect our historical inquiry. Now, what is a scholar, historian, or a sociologist to do in such a case? How do you respond to ideology, the question of ideology? One, it's easy to become ideologically neutral, as some of them will take recourse, some sociologists, some historians will take recourse to a kind of cosmopolitan neutrality, and they would become very ideologically neutral, which saves them from the risk of becoming partisan. Because if you've gotten rid of ideology, belief system, then you will not be partisan. You might be irrelevant socially, but you would not be partisan. That is one risk. The second risk is that our inquiry, our historical inquiry, sociological inquiry, becomes very overtly ideological. And I think Professor Yogendra Singh had a very nice expression for this. He would say that we would have special constituency social scientists. They would actually be social scientists, sociologists, historians, who would be very special constituency, in the sense that their inquiry would be somewhat blinkered. It would still be inquiry. It would not be propaganda. It would be academic inquiry. But if you allow the entry of ideologies, then your inquiry does become somewhat blurred, somewhat blinkered. And you are not looking at various other dimensions. So you could look at only caste. You could become a Dalit intellectual. So you are, as a Dalit intellectual, you're still very different from a propagandist. But you could still become a partisan social scientist, in the sense that you have acquired a special constituency. So one risk is constantly between what I would call becoming ideologically neutral, in which you become irrelevant, I feel, or becoming somewhat blinkered, becoming a special constituency, a social scientist or a historian. Now, these kinds of pressures are generally there in society, you know, because they would come from the field of gender, from field of caste, from the field of religion, majority, minority, you know, and a historian, what is a historian to do? I would simply say that if we say, and you know, and the tendency, there is this new tendency which says that we must recognize perspectives that are rooted in individual experiences. Mm. You know, the critique of archival research was that archival data, archival research did not tell us how people felt. People were missing in the archival data. There were no people. Their subjectivities were not there. So people, their worldview, their belief systems, their ideologies, their subjectivities, they have to be brought into the inquiry, because our inquiry is essentially all about people, which is a valid critique. But it's a valid critique, not without its own dangers and its own pitfalls. Hmm. The pitfall is that a perspective rooted in procedures of inquiry and a perspective rooted in individual or group experiences, I would not place them at par. So I think for a scholar, it's the duty or a commitment, academic commitment of a scholar to have a perspective, but that perspective has to be rooted into procedures of inquiry, data, paradigm, perspective, methodology, and so on. Hmm. And then there is a perspective which people have purely on the basis of their individual and group experiences. We must pay due cognizance to those perspectives. Right. But those perspectives, because of their intensity or because they come from victims of the societies, for that they do not become valid knowledge. Hmm. So for me, a valid knowledge is valid knowledge only if it has gone through the difficult test of data, procedures of inquiry, methodology, and so on. So for me, that is the touchstone. That is the only way in which I can separate an attitude, an sentiment, an emotion, however honorable it is. You see, many sentiments are very valid and we would like to get swayed towards it. But that does not make them valid cognitive social science ideas. Mm-hmm. For me, they become, those sentiments become valid, legitimate social science or historical ideas, cognitive ideas, only when they have passed through this test of rigorous inquiry and procedures of inquiry. So we respect sentiments, but I would not like to become a sentimental historian for that reason. It's a difficult task, but I must. It's you know, this is how, that is what his, that is the price which historical inquiry demands from me. Otherwise, I'm opening myself to populist history writing, which I think is a compromise.
We have also been familiar with you as a historian who comments on modern politics, and particularly your familiarity with deep familiarity with the modern politics in post-independent India and Congress politics, for example. And during the lockdown, and actually before lockdown, this kind of idea started coming down upon us that, you know, Congress party is probably no more relevant. But when I speak to some of my friends who closely work with Congress, they show similar kind of blind devotion toward the Congress leadership as we see in on the other side, like who are called Bhakt on the other side.
Who are called?
Bhakt.
Bhakt.
I mean, the common term is also kind of slang. In last few years, this has become a popular slang.
Bhakt. I know.
But likewise, we see some kind of bhakti on the other side. And that gives us an idea that probably the current denomination of Congress party has forgotten the history of Congress itself. I mean, the history which informs us about the kind of ups and downs which happened within Congress party and the politics, various kind of politics that emerged from this particular group of people. So, I mean, because we have seen you commenting on a popular platform on some of these issues earlier. So I thought I will ask you, I mean, this is not to suggest that you you tend to be a regular commentator on the Congress politics, but I mean, I thought it's a good idea to listen to you.
Yes, absolutely. No, it's a very important, it's a very relevant question. You see, after we became independent, so I'm not talking about Congress before 1947, because we know historically what was the role of in the national movement. After India became independent, I think Congress had a very important historical role. for Indian society. And that historical role was as follows. You see, our left, let me conventionally divide our politics into life, right, left, and the center as a kind of a spectrum, but as three very important points. The problem with our left was, and continues to be, that nobody accused the left of being dishonest or corrupt or any such thing. People would say nice things, but nobody, they would not, common people would not support left, because left was considered to be too cosmopolitan, too devoid of culture, too devoid of that warm flavor, the warm blood, the warmth of life, the traditions, the relationships, etc., etc. However bad they are, people, you know, left was so completely, it appeared so completely cosmopolitan that people did not have much taste for that kind of cosmopolitanism. So left made an appeal, strangely, a very pro-people politics in India had an appeal only to the elite, elite sections of the society. In some ways, that's true even today. So cosmopolitanism became the great handicap and weakness of the left. The problem with the right was that in the right perspective, there was a real celebration of ethnicity, celebration of identity politics, celebration of religion, knowing fully well that religion had also played a role in dividing the society just a few decades back and so on. Celebration of every form of negative dimensions of identity politics. I'm not saying that identity per se is negative, but it has a negative dimension. And that dimension was taken up by the right wing. Now, between the right and the left, what made Congress historically important and what made Congress almost indispensable was that at some level, it was not very cosmopolitan. If you look at the profile of Congress leadership and followers in the 50s, they were not all very cosmopolitan people. They were people who came from the ranks, who had risen from the ranks, and they believed some of them would practice a little bit of caste politics, a little bit of religious politics, a little bit of regional politics. So all these combinations were accommodated within the Congress, which in a way established a connection, which connected it to the people, because even people like to, there is a sense in which people are constantly looking to identify with things, and identifications happen along the lines of not just family and clan and village, but also caste and religion and language and culture and region and so on. So whereas left had closed its door, but within the Congress politics, there was a space for an identification of that kind with these kinds of features. That was there. But at the level of objectives, at the level of big picture, at the level of vision, the vision was completely of economic development, Indian nationalism. So all these factional things, if you like, or all these identitarian dimensions, if you like, they were reallocated within the party. But they were not allowed to temper with the broad objective of the country, of the party, the social transformation. The social transformation was still decided very much in Nehruvian and Gandhian terms, that India would develop as an egalitarian society. Our constitution is so egalitarian, modern society, and so on. That vision remained. Congress combined this thing. So Congress combined a bit of the right and a bit of the left, but it was able to create spaces of that kind. And that was the main success of the Congress. In the 70s, and people supported it, our intellectuals supported it. In the 50s, if you see, all the intellectuals, they would attack the Congress, they would critique the Congress in order to make it better. But they would also support the Congress, you know, through their researches, through their works, etc. So Nehru was maybe the bad man, but Nehru was also everybody's leader. I think first break came, of course, in the 70s. I'm not saying in the 60s, but 70s, when during the course of the emergency, the intellectuals left the Congress. Lot of support for the Congress. Congress was made acceptable, the ideas of the Congress, not by congressmen, but by intellectuals. So the ideas of nationalism, ideas of secularism, ideas of pluralism, ideas of social justice, ideas of federalism, ideas of developmentalism, these ideas which national movement, leaders of the national movement took to the people during the course of the national movement. But in independent India, it was not the Congress cadre which took these ideas to people. It was the intellectuals. Who took these ideas to people, because the intellectuals did not see them as Congress ideas. Intellectuals saw them as ideas emanating from our constitution and our consensual ideas of the society. during emergency, this chunk intellectuals, they broke away from the Congress. They completely broke away from the Congress. And and so in a way, the first disconnect happened there. After that, you see, Congress was an old party, great part with cadre and with the presence. It was able to form a government, etc. You know, even for a big party to decline, it takes time.
Yes, yes.
But decline kept happening. We did not realize it. And now, of course, the whole Congress it's unfortunate, but it looks irrelevant, because who are the takers for Congress? Who would indeed, instead of some people who are very unhappy with the Congress, not because of Indian nationalism, because they feel that there is no other career of these ideas of federalism, ideas of Indian nationalism, pluralism, right, secularism, etc. The great subterranean debate in our society at the moment is between some kind of monism and some kind of pluralism. Now, it's no longer communalism, secularism. It's no longer nationalism, secularism. All those debates have been subsumed within this great debate. It's not being articulated in those terms. But you scratch the surface of any debate, any big debate, and you would find that it's monism and pluralism.
Okay.
Monism tends to, I'm not talking about philosophical monism, I'm talking about monism tends to represent a kind of domination of one. This notion that now our polity, our social structure, our economy, our values should come from the domination of either one religion or one region or one party or one leader or one or the other. So this monism is becoming a very, very attractive idea. And it's something that people like us should be very, very worried about. But monism has become very attractive. The alternative idea is that of pluralism. The idea of pluralism is that, after all, this is the DNA of Indian society. This is what our constitution says. This is what our national movement said. This is what our 19th century thinkers said. Pluralism is the essence of Indian society. Now, the thing is that pluralism will always lead to a conflict.
Right.
Because leaders, there will always be, for a country like India, pluralism is a recipe which will lead to conflict. I mean, Hindu, Muslim, upper caste, lower caste, UP, Bihar, North, South. Think of a conflict and it will be there. Hindi versus some other language, English versus.
Yeah.
And therefore, monism temporarily becomes attractive to some people, because they would look upon these conflicts to be undesirable, and the conflicts can be avoided only by resorting to some kind of monism. Monism, people don't realize, will lead to many more conflicts.
Yes, yes.
Because if you impose Hindi, then people are going to resist it. If you impose domination by the North, then South is going to resist it. If you impose one kind of an upper caste vision or one party, then other non-Brahmins and Dalits will resent. Within the Dalit politics, if you impose one kind of a vision, then others will kind of challenge.
Exactly.
But in the long run, it is monism which will create many more conflicts. But in the temporary, in the immediate, in kind of a sense, orthodoxy of the times has become that many of our conflicts are because of our pluralism. Our pluralism, therefore, is not such a good thing, and we should quietly shift towards some kind of a monist discourse, monist orientation, monist politics. And therefore, those kinds of political parties are becoming important, which promote the idea of monism. Congress is losing out, because Congress was, with all its problems, it always was founded upon pluralism. And and I would like to believe that there was, within the Congress, with all its corruption, all its problems, there was a very genuine respect for pluralism of all kinds.
Yes.
Partly because Congress was an all-India party. So even during the DMK movement, during the 1965 DMK movement, some North Indian Congress were taking a Hindi position, but South Indian congressmen were taking a very anti-Hindi position, both within the Congress. And they fought each other, but they fought each other within the Congress. You know, so within Congress, there has been a very genuine pluralism. But I also feel that at the level of society and the country, there is a very great swing. There is the spirit of the times tends to be pulled in the direction of monism. That is something you should all be worried about. So the very spirit of the times makes Congress irrelevant. The irrelevant of the Congress comes because it has become smaller. It does not have enough money. It does not have enough willpower. It does not have a very determined, dedicated cadre. The leadership doesn't seem to be worried about things. All that is there. But much more than all that, I think what we all should worry about is that the spirit of the times seems to be impelled seem to be propelled rather in the direction of monism, and that seems to be then dictating our choices, the parties people vote for, the groups people vote for, the groups which are more political parties, which are more powerful, and so on. So that I hope is a short-term thing, but I hope it's short-term. I hope people realize that in the long run we must return towards our own flavor, towards pluralism. But as of now, there is a very serious problem, and Congress is a part of this problem.
Yes, looks like. So this can go on and on. I mean, there is plenty to talk about when you were there. But let me bring it toward the closure. So what occupies you most when you are free from all your administrative responsibility and when you are not thinking about the current situation of Congress? When you're not thinking of history, what you enjoy doing most? I mean, what kind of, to be very precise, straight away, I'm asking about the kind of music that you're listening to these days.
Well, this COVID crisis, I have now realized what my retired life is going to be like.
Okay.
This is what it will be like. I like to be with people because that was again a very JNU thing, that ideas developed only through a kind of dialogue and through disagreements, etc. Ideas of all kinds, you know, and relationships developed, and we were enriched by our relationships, friends and batchmates and so on. That what was true for those times is true even for today. But unfortunately, this pandemic has deprived us of those kinds of friendships, times together, relationships, and so on. So I do feel quite, most of us do feel quite deprived. So when I'm not doing anything else, I basically divide my time between a little bit of, I have been nominated the president of the modern session of the Indian History Congress for this year. Okay. So I basically try and look up my, whatever books I have at home, I try and work towards my presidential address. And then, of course, music, songs, films, YouTube. Fortunately, YouTube is there.
Yeah.
So whatever you want to listen to, whatever film you want to see is there. So basically, our songs from Hindi cinema of the 50s and 60s, that is my favorite choice. And my films, again, from Hollywood of 50s and 60s. So when it comes to songs, I tend to turn to the Bombay cinema of 50s and 60s and a little bit of 70s. And when it comes to my choice of movies, then I turn to Hollywood of the black and white Hollywood romantic cinema of the 40s and the 50s and the 60s. So that 50, is what I
50s, 60s is the time when you had Bimal Roy and your favorite musician, Salil Chaudhary.
Salil Chaudhary, S.D. Burman, So that was the best time. That was the best time of our cinema.
Yes, no doubt. I fully agree with that.